Tantor Audio presents Soarer's Choice by L.E. Modesitt, Jr. Narrated by Kyle McCarley. Green towers rise against a setting sun, proud monuments to choices ill begun, spare spires of eternal stone to stand, and long imprisoned spirits of the land. Alectors' choices fell on friends and foes. They struck with force, righteousness, and woes. Heeded not good or grace when day was done, and greater powers had turned stars and sun. 1. Dainyl sat behind the wide desk in the large study in headquarters. On the desk were stacks of reports. To his left, on the polished wood, was a shorter stack, the immediate orders he had written for the Myrmidons in an effort to undo the worst of his predecessor's plotting. Outside, the morning sunlight of late harvest warmed the courtyard and the blue-winged pterodons of First Company, those that were not flying dispatches and undertaking other duties. The solid granite of the courtyard and the walls sparkled in the bright sun, clean and crisp. He'd permanently reassigned the 7th Company of Myrmidons to Tempra from Dulca to keep them from being suborned by Quiverit, the regional elector in Dulca, and clearly the tool of Brekhilt, the elector of the East in Alastra. After that had come the cover letter forwarding copies of Dainyl's appointment as marshal to each of the 8 Myrmidon companies spread across Corus. Beside those lay the draft of his report on what he had done to quash the revolt in Hialt and Tempra. Of course, he couldn't tell the entire story because his superior, the High Elector of Justice, the Most Honorable Zeliert, had firmly ordered him to treat the matter as a local revolt, rather than the first thrust of a conspiracy masterminded by Brekhilt. To make matters worse, and more delicate, Dainyl suspected that Brekhilt was being quietly urged on by Samist, the Duarch of Ludar. Dainyl looked up from the various papers and back out through the window at the nearest pterodon in the courtyard behind the headquarters building, standing on its wide, raised stone square and stretching its blue leathery wings. The long, crystalline beak glittered in the sunlight. After a moment, Dainyl's eyes dropped back to the papers before him. Despite the proclamation that lay on his table desk and the green-edged gold stars on the collars of his blue and gray shimmer silk uniform that attested to his rank, Dainyl still didn't feel like the Marshal of Myrmidons. Add to that the fact that he was dreading the translation trip to Alastra, but the longer he waited, the more dangerous the situation became, and it wasn't something he could delegate. For one thing, he didn't have anyone to whom he could delegate the task. He'd been the submarshal in Elsine, and Colonel Denner, who had been the Myrmidon operations director, had attempted to kill Dainyl when Dainyl had discovered Denner's treachery. Dainyl was the only senior officer left in headquarters. The other submarshal, Alcina, was stationed in Alastra, the width of the continent away. For years, she had directed Myrmidon operations in the East, and she was one of the reasons Dainyl had to go to Alastra, and before long. He took a deep breath and reached for the next document on the top of the taller pile. In less than a glass, he was due at the palace of the Duarch in Elsine to meet with Duarch Kellerit to brief him personally on all that had happened in Hialt and Tempra. He assumed that he would also be asked for his plans for the Myrmidons. That possibility worried him far more than explaining the past, because he doubted that it would be wise to reveal the reasons behind what he planned until he had a better idea of what the Duarch and those around him already knew. Still, He needed to finish catching up on the other Myrmidon and Cadmian operations, or as many as he could, before he met with the Duarch. He began to read the report from Colonel Harold, commander of the 1st Regiment Cadmian Mounted Rifles. When he finished, Dainyl couldn't help but frown. Except for 2nd Battalion, every battalion in the 1st Regiment was under strength, and the colonel was reporting that matters were worsening. And why in the Archon's name had a battalion been sent to Supat? The mines there were marginal. At least, he thought so. But it wouldn't hurt to ask Lystrana. As a chief assistant in the palace of the Duarch, his wife might know the trade and finance background. Slowly, he got up and headed for the records chamber. Doselt, the squad leader in charge of records, then jumped to his feet.
Yes, Marshal?
Would you find me the records of and the orders to the 1st Cadmian Regiment that deal with the deployment of its 6th Battalion to Supat last season?
It might take a bit, sir.
Just bring them to me. If I'm not here, leave them on the corner of my desk.
Yes, sir.
Dainyl moved down the corridor to see if Captain Gasilt was in his study. Dainyl needed some help, and he needed it now. Gasilt might be out in the courtyard. He spent more time flying or with the pterodons than did many company commanders. Dainyl was fortunate. The captain was standing by his desk, holding a report, looking at it quizzically. He dropped it on the table.
Sir? Gasilt, you know that we have no operations director.
Yes, sir.
Gasilt swallowed.
No, sir.
No, sir?
Dainyl couldn't help smiling.
I'm a flyer, sir. I can't do operations and scheduling and paperwork.
Your reports are excellent,
Dainyl pointed out.
That's because I don't do them. Under Captain Zernaltar does. She has for years.
Dainyl laughed.
I might steal her then.
She writes well, sir. I'd hate to lose her, but she'd do better than I would.
Where is she?
She's on the dispatch run from Luda. She won't be back until late.
Would you leave word that I would like to see her?
Yes, sir.
Gasilt sounded disconsolate.
If she works out, she won't get jumped 3 ranks to colonel,
Dainyl said.
She'll be a captain and assistant operations director.
Of course, there might not be an operations director for a while, but Dainyl needed the job done.
And you could still make major without doing much paperwork.
He grinned.
If you can find another undercaptain who can write.
Gonna's not bad. Chelistar's nearly as good as Zernaltar, but don't steal her. She's the best squad leader in the air.
Dainyl made a mental note to jot that down when he got back to his study. He could never tell when he might need another good company commander. He'd also have to check on Gasilt. He might be able to promote him to major anyway. The commanding officer of the Elsine Company probably ought to be one, and Dainyl needed a good flying commander and loyalty as much as he needed an operations officer.
I appreciate the information, and even more, I appreciate your honesty and loyalty. These days, it means a great deal.
Although Gasilt's expression remained politely attentive, Dainyl sensed the concealed surprise and gratitude.
We need to talk, before too long, about what may lie ahead for you and First Company.
Yes, sir.
Dainyl nodded, then turned and headed back toward his study. He didn't make it.
The duty coach is ready, sir.
That was under Captain Uasilt, the duty officer.
I'll be there in a moment.
Dainyl paused. There was nothing he really needed in his study. He turned and headed toward the archway to the front entrance. Outside, waiting with the coach, was Wyalt. As always, the duty driver had a smile on his face when Dainyl strode out of headquarters.
Good morning, Marshal.
Good morning, Wyalt. The Dew Arch's palace.
Yes, sir.
Dainyl stepped up into the coach and closed the door. Once the coach began to move, he concentrated on how best to brief the Dew Arch. Some of that would depend on whether Kellerit wanted a private briefing or one that included other high electors. As the duty coach neared the Dew Arch's palace, Dainyl looked out at Elsine, a city built on an isle of stone and tile and gardens and trees, orderly and vibrant, with stone-walled dwellings set on tree-lined streets, shops with their perfect tile roofs set around market squares that held everything produced on Corus. Goods shipped from across the world flowed from the wharves and docks on the southern shore into endless warehouses and to everyone in Elsine, electors and landers alike. His eyes lingered on the twin green towers flanking the palace, soaring into the silver-green sky, gleaming and glittering in the mid-morning sunlight, symbolically crowning the accomplishments of the electors of Corus, who had turned a freezing and dying world into a place of life and achievement. Even as he marveled at the towers, Dainyl recalled the words of the ancient Soarer.
You must change, or you will die.
That seemed so unlikely, yet the ancient had been so certain, and so melancholy in saying those words. The coach slowed and came to a halt under the portico at the main entrance to the Dew Arch's palace. Dainyl stepped out.
I'll be waiting for you, sir,
Wyalt called down from the driver's seat. Dainyl almost told him to return to headquarters because others might need him, but cut off the words before he spoke. There wasn't anyone there who would need the coach, not without a submarshal or an operations director.
Thank you. I don't know how long I'll be.
I'll be here, sir.
Dainyl made his way in through the archway, past the pair of guards armed with light-cutter sidearms. He did not recall the slender elector who met him inside the main foyer of the palace, although his face was vaguely familiar, but it was clear that the functionary knew Dainyl.
Marshal, the Dew Arch is ready to see you, if you would accompany me.
He turned down the high-ceilinged hallway, flanked by golden stone marble columns that led to the east wing of the palace. The hall was floored with the traditional octagonal tiles of green marble, linked by smaller diamond tiles of gold marble, and dark green velvet hangings between the golden stone columns were trimmed in gold. The sound of Dainyl's boots hitting the octagonal and diamond-shaped marble floor tiles was lost in the expanse of the corridor. Near the end of the corridor, the elector turned to his right and knocked on a door. After the briefest of moments, he opened it and motioned for Dainyl to enter, then followed the marshal into the chamber. It was the same small library, 6 yards wide and 12 in length, where Dainyl had met with the Dew Arch on the one previous occasion he had briefed Kellerit. The inside walls held oak shelves filled with volumes, while the outside wall contained smaller sections of shelves. The narrow floor-to-ceiling windows between the built-in bookcases overlooked the southern sunken garden. The Dew Arch rose from behind his desk. This time, unlike the last, it was almost empty instead of being stacked high with books. Standing, he was an immense presence, close to 3 yards tall, with shimmering black hair and deep violet eyes dominating his alabaster face. He radiated talent.
Thank you, Barrett.
The Dew Arch's voice was deep but warm. He turned from the aide to Dainyl and gestured to a chair set across the wide desk from him.
Please, Marshal.
Dainyl bowed and seated himself. Behind him, the door clicked shut.
Dainyl, first, let me offer my congratulations and my gratitude.
With the words came a feeling of warmth. Dainyl did not trust that feeling entirely, because he had no idea whether it was genuine. The Duarch was so accomplished with talent and shields that he could conceivably project the feeling without revealing what lay behind the projected emotion.
I understand from what the High Elector has said,
continued Kellerit,
and from what he has refrained from saying, that the incidents in Heolt and Tempra were far more than the minor revolt that is the official description. I also understand that you had anticipated this possibility and were ordered not to act until actual misuse of life force energies occurred.
Dainyl waited. He had not been asked a question.
You are deferential, Marshal.
As I should be, sir. Would you like a fuller explanation of the events?
I will request two explanations. The first will be a complete one, and that is for me alone. The second one will be for several other High Electors, those of Finance and Transport, and the High Elector of Engineering from Ludar. You will not tell them everything, and based on what you tell me, I will suggest what should go no farther. You may proceed.
Yes, sir.
Dainyl cleared his throat. Even though he had planned what to say, carefully, he was still less than sanguine about briefing the Duarch, because he knew that, despite Kellerit's immense talent, the shadow match conditioning of a Duarch resulted in blind spots and seeming irrationalities.
It began in early spring when I visited Alastra, under the orders of Marshal Shastilt and the High Elector of Justice. There, I discovered a number of patterns, small things seemingly, that suggested all was not as it should be.
He went on to tell about Breckhilt's comments, what he had discovered about the substitution of key Myrmidon personnel, and then about the attacks on him, both by the regional elector in Dulca and by the then-commanding officer of the 7th Myrmidon Company. He also mentioned the diversion of engineering resources at Fordall and the mysterious deaths used to cover up the details, as well as some of the attacks on him by the recorders of deeds, but only those that had taken place in the table chambers, and not those occurring while he had been in transit between tables. Those incidents would have revealed far too much about his own abilities.
And when Relin complained about a wild lander talent in Heolt, but declined firmly any Myrmidon assistance, it was clear to me that we needed to move against Relin before matters became even worse.
This was when Marshal Shastilt ordered you to await further developments? Was that because Relin was regional elector and recorder of deeds in Heolt?
I assume so, sir. Shastilt told me that to act immediately would be unwise.
What prompted him to change that decision?
That happened some weeks later, when I received a copy of a report from Academy and Battalion Commander in Heolt suggesting that road-building equipment had been constructed and modified to be used against both Cadmians and Myrmidons.
You received a copy directly? Is that not unusual?
It was very unusual. The Major had sent the original to his commander, as per regulations, but a copy to me. It was clear he feared that too much delay in relaying what he discovered would be unfortunate. When Marshal Shastilt read the report, he ordered me to proceed.
Dainyl went on to describe the use of 5th Company pterodons out of Derica rather than 1st Company from Elsine.
You did not trust your own officers, Marshal?
I trust 1st Company totally, sir, but it was clear to me from the beginning that Colonel Denner was someone's tool. I had absolutely no proof, and frankly I was less than certain about what Marshal Shastilt was doing.
As you, unfortunately, had every right to be.
The other aspect of the matter that was especially troubling were the weapons that were used by the forces of Regional Elector Farhilt. He had created his own regional force of armed and mounted rifles, using landers and indigens and a smaller force of electors armed with light-cutter sidearms. The mounted rifle companies even had unmarked Cadmian weapons. Those I left in Cadmian custody, but the light-cutters were sent under seal to High Elector Zeliot.
Dainyl could sense the Duarch's surprise even before Kelleret spoke.
How did that come to pass? Arming steers for use against Cadmians, and electors with light cutters?
The sudden chill in the library matched the coldness of the Duarch's voice, and the talent force of the Duarch felt strong enough to shake the entire palace. Belatedly, Dainyl realized that might have been a projection of an illusion, although he wasn't so sure of what had been real talent and what had been illusion.
That I do not know. I suspect that the lightcutters came from Fordol, and might be another aspect of the engineering problems that resulted in Zestafin's death. Fordol was certainly where the light cannon used in Heolt originated.
How do you know those did not come from Fatel?
I don't, sir. But if they did not come from Fordol, why did someone go to the extremes of creating mishaps and deaths and trying to cover up the use of additional resources in Fordol? And why were there no such diversions in Fatel?
Why, indeed. Please continue.
It's likely that the unmarked rifles did come from Fatel. If Shastilt's and High Elector Zeliot's assurances to me about the source of the unmarked rifles happen to be correct...
They were correct. And there were far more unmarked rifles produced than were initially accounted for. So you are doubtless correct in that supposition.
Whether the light cannon and the light cutters came from Fordol or Fatel, then their presence, and that of the rifles, suggests that either the High Elector of Engineering or someone high in engineering was involved.
That is doubtless correct. But you will not mention that in briefing the High Electors. Only note that the rifles and light weapons were present in large numbers in the hands of indigent steers who were rebels.
Yes, sir.
Pardon me, Marshal. Please, continue.
A smile followed the words, dispersing the sense of doom and chill.
There isn't much more to add. When I returned, Shastilt was so shocked that it led to his death, as I told you earlier, and Colonel Denner was so upset when I suggested that I now had proof of his treachery that he attempted to kill me on the spot with his sidearm.
Did you threaten him?
Only with the fact that I had proof. I did raise my shields.
And he added to your proof. Fatally.
Kelleret laughed, deeply and warmly.
Did Shastilt say much before his unfortunate... shock?
He said it would be easy to prove that Sub-Marshal Alcina and I were planning a coup.
He told me that you had gone to Heolt without orders, and he was concerned. That seemed unlike you.
Dainyl wasn't at all surprised at that revelation.
He was the one who ordered me to keep everything secret.
That wasn't quite true. So had High Elector Zeliot.
Why did you?
Because not doing so would have endangered the Myrmidons and Cadmians involved far more.
So you put your people ahead of other considerations?
No, sir.
Then Dainyl shook his head.
Not exactly, sir. What I meant was that I might not have had the resources to deal with each problem had they occurred at once, which was likely if information leaked out before I could get the Myrmidons from Fifth Company to Heald. We were able to isolate Heald. That meant the Cadmeans did not have to fight the mounted rifles from Tempera while guarding the perimeters, and that Fifth Company did not have to deal with the misguided orders of Seventh Company while subduing Heald.
Put that way, your actions are commendable. How do you propose to keep such misunderstandings from occurring in the future?
I had thought to promote Sub-Marshal Alcina to headquarters, immediately, with a personal visit to Alastra.
That might be for the best, under the circumstances.
The Duarch tilted his head to the side, and a humorous smile appeared.
From what I have gathered, when one of the Fifth Company Myrmidons was killed, you took his pterodon and led the attacks. You were also instrumental, I understand, in keeping the casualties to a minimum in persuading Seventh Company that their orders were misguided. You also came up with a novel means of dealing with command in Seventh Company.
How had the Duarch known that? Dainyl did not reply for a moment, then managed to smile but slightly as he realized the source, belatedly recognizing a certain resemblance. Yet, if the Duarch were conditioned against receiving or reading any communications from his daughters, it had to be under Captain Asurk, acting under Captain Lysata's orders. He risked a guess.
She is exceedingly courageous, sir, but I would not have guessed her heritage.
Say no more, Dainyl. Your thoughtfulness and courage are greater than any marshal in generations. Let us trust that they are sufficient for the challenges ahead, and that they will help us bring the Master Scepter to Acorus.
The Duarch's face froze, if but for the tiniest fraction of an instant. Dainyl could sense that conflict between what Kellerit almost knew and was not allowed to accept. Even knowing that, Dainyl barely managed not to betray his total shock.
You look concerned. Is it not best that the Master Scepter be transferred here?
I am concerned, sir. I have done my best, but even so, much life force was squandered in the process, and you had told me earlier that the decision was close and hinged on the surplus of life force.
That wasn't quite what the Duarch had said, but what he had implied, and it was the best Dainyl could offer. Abruptly, the Duarch nodded, as if he had heard enough.
You did manage to minimize the loss of life force, especially by destroying hundreds of the rebel electors from Ifrin, who had no authority to be on Acorus.
Dainyl kept his expression pleasant and waited.
All is judged on life force mass, yet today's measurement does not always reflect what it will be tomorrow or next year, nor what a world will be or could be.
Yes, sir.
As always, as with all those who serve the Duarchy and the Archon, you have not told me everything, have you?
No, sir. As I told you the last time you requested my presence, we would be here for days were I to do that. I will be happy to answer any questions you may have, now or in the future, or to provide more details about anything.
That you will.
Kellerit laughed, not quite harshly, but the laugh was followed by a sense of warmth.
How is Lystrana faring with your child?
She fares well.
That is good. She is one of the best chief assistants to any of the High Electors.
So I would believe, sir, although I am less than unbiased. She would do well at anything.
You think so?
Kellerit asked, almost jokingly.
She has excellent judgment and can see much of what others do not.
All Dainyl wanted to do was plant the germ of an idea.
And we are fortunate that she does.
The chill feeling returned to the library.
Continue to be careful in what you believe of Zeliot, Dainyl. He sees both more and less than he thinks he does. Be most careful.
Another smile appeared, this one rueful, as he rose again from behind the desk.
It is time for you to brief the others.
Dainyl followed Kelleret out through the library door and down the corridor. 4 Elector guards appeared, 2 walking beside him and 2 beside the Duarch, escorting them to a conference room, scarcely larger than the library, but containing only a large circular table with comfortable chairs, and 3 Electors in shimmer silk greens. Walking into the conference room was like flying into the eye of a storm. While the chamber was calm, Dainyl was all too aware of the talent forces that circled around him. Yet the only one he truly feared for might of talent was the Duarch. The other 3 Electors who stood waiting around the table exuded talent, but individually, not that much more than did he, and he doubted if any had shields as strong as his. Still, he certainly could not have prevailed against any 2 together, or the Duarch alone, not that he ever wished to be in such a position. Dainyl had seen all 3 High Electors at functions, but only from a modest distance. Chembrit was the High Elector of Finance, for whom Lystrana was the chief assistant. Alcyril was High Elector of Transport, and Ruvrin was the High Elector of Engineering. Dainyl had to wonder why Ruvrin was even in Elsine, since he was based in the southern capital of Ludar and reported directly to the Duarch Samist.
Before we have our meeting, Kelleret said quietly, I have asked Marshal Dainyl to brief you on the recent events in Heolt and Tempra.
The Duarch seated himself, as did the other High Electors. Dainyl hoped he was to remain standing. It seemed appropriate, and no one had motioned for him to seat himself. He cleared his throat and started.
There have been many rumors and stories, so I've been told, about what happened in Heolt. I doubt that we will ever know all the reasons for what happened, but the Myrmidons were drawn into the situation when we began to receive reports of strange events in Heolt. Then we received a documented report from a Cadmian officer that verified that there were Electors in uniforms testing and practicing with light cannon.
Dainyl made the summary as brief as he dared, concluding less than a quarter of a glass later,
The entire complex at Heolt will require rebuilding, but there was little damage in Tempra. Paradoxically, the table damage in Heolt appears far less grave than that in Tempra.
Does anyone have any questions?
Asked the Duarch.
I presume the Myrmidons will supply immediate transport for table engineers from Fatal and Ludar,
Ruvrin stated bluntly.
Second company in Ludar should be able to transport any engineers from Ludar, and first company will transport those from Fatal. As soon as you inform me of the numbers and any limited supplies, we will make arrangements.
You should have those within the next few days, Marshal.
Chembrit smiled at Dainyl. Dainyl could sense the thrust coming, but not at him.
You had mentioned that the Elector rebels in Heolt possessed light cannon,
began Chembrit.
That the Elector rebels in Tempra had Myrmidon-type hand sidearms, and that the mounted rifles of the former RA in Tempra had Cadmian rifles. Did you verify this?
Yes, sir. The light cannon killed 3 Myrmidons from 5th Company, and 2 Pteridons and 2 Myrmidons from 7th Company. The Lightcutter sidearms were collected and are now under seal and custody of the High Elector of Justice. The Cadmeans took custody of the rifles. I personally inspected all three types of weapons.
Do you have any ideas as to their sources?
Chembrit did not even glance toward Ruvren.
The rifles were identical in every particular, with the exception of serial numbers, with the Cadmean weapons. There is no doubt that they were manufactured either in Fatal or Fordol, but I have no way of knowing which it might be. As for the other weapons, I lack the engineering skills to determine where they may have been built or originated, save that there were no facilities at either Heolt or Tempra where that could have been accomplished.
Thank you.
Ruvren did not smile as he looked at Dainyl.
Marshal, were you aware that proceeding without written orders from Marshal Shastilt or the High Elector of Justice verges on breaking the code, and that could have created an even greater instability and loss of life force?
I had thought of that, sir, but I was ordered to do so, and insubordination is definitely against the code.
After the brevity of Dainyl's reply, there was silence, but only for a moment, when Alcerel coughed slightly.
I don't believe you mentioned exactly how many rebel electors there were, Marshal.
We can't be absolutely certain how many there were, because some may have escaped one way or another. We did find the remains of more than 300.
300? You killed 300 electors?
Yes, sir. My orders were to put down the revolt. When I attempted to visit R.A. Relin, even before I could dismount from the Pteridon, we were attacked. There was never any attempt to communicate with us, and they refused to consider surrendering.
That was in Heolt. What about Tempra?
What were the casualties among the mounted rifle companies of the so-called Elector's Guard?
Did you attempt to avoid the initial conflict between 5th and 7th companies?
Dainyl answered questions for another quarter glass before the Duarch raised a hand.
I think the Marshal has been forthright. He has done his best to preserve life force and to ensure that Acorus is prepared to receive the Master Scepter. Thank you, Marshal. You may go.
Yes, sir.
Dainyl was more stunned by the total lack of reaction, even hidden, to the Duarch's statement about the Master Scepter than by his abrupt release. Even so, he bowed slightly and stepped to the door, letting himself out. Another pair of Elector guards escorted him back to the entry foyer with its high arched dome. He was more than glad to step out into the rotunda and walk toward the waiting duty coach. What awaited him back at headquarters seemed far more manageable than what faced Kellerit. 2. Under a clear, silver-green sky, the late morning sunlight fell across the low rise to the north of Heolt. From the saddle of the roan, Mikkel surveyed the nearly completed Cadmean compound, standing out amid the tannish grasses of the grazing lands to the north. While he'd been occupied in fighting the rebel electors at Tempra and then recovering from his injuries, all the walls had been completed, and the paving of the interior was a third done. That included the areas around the gates, which could now be hung and secured in place. Both the barracks and the stables looked finished on the outside, anyway. Work was beginning on digging out the roadbed south of the gates so that a stone-paved road to the high road could be built once the interior paving was finished.
You've done wonders, Riston.
Mikkel turned to the senior captain mounted beside him. The captain's aura remained a deep brown, so deep it verged on black, but showed no sign of the green streaks that indicated the possibility of possessing the same talent as Mikkel did, and as did almost all Alectors. In convalescing, Mickle had finally made the connection between what the Soarer had told him a year before and what the one Elector at Hialt had called him in trying to kill him. A wild talent. The Soarer had told him to find his talent, but he hadn't realized that the Elector's term for his emerging abilities was talent. "How did you manage it?" Mickle asked. Riston offered a sheepish grin.
"Well, Major, I kept telling the craftmasters that it wouldn't be all that long before you got back, and I really didn't want to have to explain why things weren't farther along."
Mickle forced a smile and a chuckle. "You're a scoundrel." Behind the expression, he was both bemused and appalled. "I suppose Troll pressed you on the blankets."
"No, sir. Not once."
"How are things going with Kizma? Do you think he'll be able to handle the compound once we're sent back?"
"He's been very attentive. He has asked a few questions about you, indirectly."
Mickle wasn't sure he wanted to know. "Such as?"
"Whether you were the son of an ancient."
"What?" Mickle shook his head. "My father's a tiler in Fatal, and my mother was a weaver before they married. Why would he ask that?"
"One of the Hialt and Cadmians swears he saw you with an ancient up on the hillside by the old garrison."
Riston raised his eyebrows.
"You have to admit, Major, that more than a few strange things have occurred around you."
Mickle had been afraid he'd been observed, but it meant that the ranker who had seen him had some of the same talent he did. Otherwise, the man would have seen nothing. "Many of them would have happened to you if you'd been in charge." Riston laughed, shaking his head.
"I don't think so, sir."
Mickle shrugged, then smothered a wince. His back was still tender, and doubtless would be for days more. Then, if it hadn't been for Rachela, he probably would be in far worse condition, if he were still even alive. Had it been a mistake to give her the dagger of the ancients? What else could he have done? He'd tried kindness, understanding, and she'd still insisted he was her enemy. Mickle knew they were somehow tied together, but Rachela's attitude had varied from grudging respect to outright hostility, all of it bordered with a large amount of condescension. When he thought about it, Mickle wondered why he cared, except that he had the feeling that she was caught in what amounted to an invisible prison, and that she would be a far different person were she not. But was that only wistful thinking? Riston eased his mount up beside Mickle.
"Sir, I haven't asked, not where anyone could overhear, but what did happen in Tempra? There's all sorts of rumors from the factors, and the men have picked them up. They said that a building fell on you, and you walked away from the rubble, and that you'd killed 20 Electors, the rebels, that is, by yourself."
The last part was all too close to the truth, but it wasn't something Mickle wanted spread about, particularly among his Cadmian rankers. He shook his head. "There was an explosion of some Elector device they'd hidden in the lower level of the regional Elector's headquarters. I got flattened by some of the stones. The building is very much intact, except for part of one door and a doorway. Altogether, the three companies did kill close to 20 of the rebels, but that took all three companies. And you've seen the casualties." Riston snorted.
"You lost 63 men in Tempra out of slightly less than 300. Against irregulars and Raelys, that would be on the high side, but not by that much. Losing that few against Electors armed with those light cutters is unbelievable.
It takes 5 to 10 shots, unless they're headshots, just to knock them down.
Mickle was grateful Riston didn't mention the other exception besides headshots, that Mickle was doing the shooting. I kept the men behind stone walls, and the rebel electors didn't seem to have much sense of tactics. I don't think any of them had ever been in a real fight.
Probably not.
Then there was something else. Mickle frowned. He'd thought of it earlier and was having trouble recalling what it had been. Riston waited. Oh, their weapons. They're all the kind that are designed to kill, usually instantly.
So will a rifle bullet,
replied Riston dryly. It's not the same thing. A myrmidon fires one of those sky lances and anything in its path is gone, up in flame. With those uniforms that they wear, they'd have to have weapons like that, but how many times do they use them? After a moment, Riston nodded.
I see what you mean. All their battles tend to be shorter. Even when they did a siege of the regional elector's compound here, the actual battle took less than half a day. Most of that was sniping and preparation. The heavy fighting when they broke in was over in less than a glass.
I'm guessing, but I think one reason why we won in Tempera was that, well, they ran out of ammunition, or whatever passes for ammunition, and there was no one to resupply them.
You realize, Major, that you're a very dangerous man to the electors.
Me? Mickle had his own ideas as to that, and they concerned his talent, but he wanted to hear what Riston had to say.
You're among the few that know what their vulnerabilities are, and how to fight them successfully. You've figured out what weapons we could make that would be effective in taking them out, and at least some of them respect you. And I would not be surprised if some were afraid of you.
That's absurd. This time Riston shrugged.
The word's out how you back down a Myrmidon captain, or under-captain, and how the Sub-Marshal of Myrmidons made a special trip to see you when he discovered you were wounded. I don't know of any time ever when a Myrmidon officer checked on a Cadmian, let alone the number two man in all the Myrmidons.
I'm sure he was only after information.
Fabritol said that he didn't ask anything except about your health and how you knew the rebels were rebels, and that was because Fabritol couldn't tell him.
Mickle shifted his weight in the saddle. I never thought about it that way. And he hadn't. But then, he had not been in the best of shape when Sub-Marshal Dainyl had sought him out at Rachelaw's. He forced a grin. You're just as dangerous. You know everything that I've figured out. In fact, some of it you worked out before I did.
I've thought of that,
Riston replied.
That's one reason why I'd rather remain a captain for a while. No one pays much attention to Cadmian captains, unless their commander is an idiot like Vaclan, or a Hersiod.
Although Mickle hadn't thought about Hersiod for months, Riston's comment jarred his memory. He managed not to swallow. The purpleness that had tinged Hersiod. That was what happened to people who spent much time around electors. But could that also mean that somehow the electors had used their abilities on the Major, making him intransigent like Vaclan had been? Mickle wondered if Vaclan had been influenced by the electors. He'd met with them, and he'd said he'd only had a short meeting, but the reports Mickle had gotten had suggested a far longer meeting. But why would the electors influence Cadmian officers?
Major? Sir? You have that look again. The one that means trouble.
Although Riston's tone was humorous, Mickle could sense the concern behind the humor. I was wondering if Hersiod spent any time with the Myrmidon Marshal.
Of course he did. He and the Colonel were briefed personally about the Ironstem problems,
Can you think of any reason why the Myrmidons would want Hesiod and Vaklin to act stupidly? Riston's face hardened.
Frigg. They both meet with Myrmidons, and they both started acting like ill-tempered asses, instead of the simple asses they were before. I should have seen it.
He shook his head.
But it doesn't make sense. If the Alectors wanted to screw things up, it didn't work. You and Doak are far better commanders than Vaklin was. I'd bet that the senior captain in 4th Battalion is better than Hesiod.
Who would know that? In the Myrmidons? And whom did they meet with? Countered Mickle. The Submarshal is the one who promoted me and Doak. Hesiod and Vaklin met with the Marshal. And we had a rebellion of Alectors here in Heolt and in Tempra.
You're suggesting that the Submarshal and the Marshal are on different sides, with different agendas?
I don't know. But it's something to keep in mind. From what I've seen, I'd trust the Submarshal more, but I'm not sure any of them are looking out for us.
Sometimes I wonder if any of the senior officers do.
They have their own ideas. Mickle smiled faintly.
And it doesn't seem to matter what it costs us.
Has that ever changed?
No.
Riston studied the compound for several moments before speaking again.
Do you know where we'll be posted after we finish here?
Unless we get different orders, we report that we're ready to turn the compound over to Kizmer and Matorak. Then we get specific orders from the Colonel as to how we're to head back to Northar. And the way things are going, we may have to ride the whole way. Mickle snorted. If we're lucky, we could ride to Tempra and take a barge or a boat down the Vedra. That'd make more sense.
Don't count on it, sir.
I won't. Mickle urged the gelding forward. I need to take a closer look at the compound. 3. Dainyl did not get home until far later than usual, because he'd discussed with Gashilt the need for another Myrmidon to succeed Wyalt in training as duty driver and flyer, as well as catching up on the problems of First Company. Then he had waited for Under-Captain Zernalta to return from her dispatch run from Ludar. Dainyl had asked her to try the position as Assistant Operations Director on a temporary basis, without giving up her Pterodon, to see if she would be happy with it. She'd agreed, with reservations.
The writing part doesn't bother me, sir, and I've been doing most of First Company's scheduling for the captain, but for all the companies?
In practical terms, right now you'd be mainly scheduling First Company and occasionally Seventh Company out of Tempra.
Tempra, sir?
Zernalta's black eyebrows lifted.
They've been transferred there from Dulka. Why don't you give it a try and we'll talk at the end of next week? If it works, you'll be promoted to captain.
Dainyl hadn't mentioned that she and Gashilt would be the senior officers in headquarters any time he was absent, at least until he dealt with Alcina. By the time he left headquarters, he was a good glass and a half late, and he didn't feel that badly about using the duty coach. It didn't hurt that Wyalt was cheerful. When he walked in the door, Lystrana was waiting in the foyer. Her frown vanished, and the relief in her deep violet eyes was obvious. She stepped forward and embraced him.
I was worried. I heard from Chembrit that you'd had to brief the High Electors in the Dewarch. And when you weren't here...
I had to wait for Zernilta to return from Ludar. I twisted her arm a bit to get her to try being Assistant Operations Director.
There isn't anyone else, is there?
She took his arm.
Dinner is waiting.
I'm sorry.
I think I'll be getting used to it.
How is Katra?
His eyes dropped to the slight swelling of her abdomen.
She was a bit upset when I got worried. She can sense that.
That's a sign of talent. Were you like that?
Why do you ask?
Because I certainly wasn't, he replied with a laugh, reaching out and tousling her shimmering black hair, cut short just above her elegant neck. The sun was so low in the west that, while the sky was still light, both the dining room and the sunroom were shadowed by the courtyard walls. Both Zistel and Sentia, the blonde Lander serving girls, were already setting the platters on the table when Lystrina and Dainyl entered the room. He looked through the archway into the sunroom and to the courtyard beyond, with its garden and fountain, then turned to the girls.
Do we have any ale?
Yes, sir, replied Sentia. Would you like some?
Please.
Dainyl sat slowly.
Your stomach is a little uneasy.
Lystrina settled herself across from him. He nodded.
It's been a long day.
I hope the fowl isn't too dry. There is a cream sauce. I had Zistel make it to go with the noodles.
You didn't get home all that early yourself, did you?
She grinned at him.
No. We had some problems. I'll tell you later, when you tell me about your day.
Here is your ale, sir.
Sentia placed a pitcher and beaker on the table, not quite beside the pitcher of cider for Lystrina.
Thank you so much.
Dainyl served Lystrina and then himself. He took two small swallows of ale before he began to eat.
The weather has been wonderful. I hope it stays this warm into fall.
So do I,
he replied. As was their custom, neither talked of their work while they ate, nor until they retired to their bedchamber on the upper level, and the girls had gone to their quarters on the lower level. Lystrina had slipped into a gown and robe and stretched out on the large bed, while Dainyl slowly disrobed and hung up his blue and gray shimmer silk uniform.
How did it go with Kellerit?
I briefed him first and gave a shorter presentation to the three High Electors. I don't know why Ruvrin was there. He didn't look that happy, and he asked a few sharp questions.
He was there because he'd been summoned by both Kellerit and my highest about more irregularities in the engineering accounts. I'll tell you about them when you're done.
I was a little nervous. I've briefed the Duarch before, once, but never any of the High Electors, except Zelliot, and he wasn't there.
I'm sure he felt he knew what you had to say.
He knows more than I said, and he may not have wanted to reveal anything.
Dainyl paused.
It's worse than I thought. Everyone just nodded at the story of the Limited Revolt. It's as though no one wants to admit that there's a bigger problem. At the end, Kellerit commended me for limiting life force losses and my efforts to make sure that the Master Scepter comes to Corus.
He shook his head.
I really thought he understood that it's effectively been decided that it's going to Ephra, but it's as if all the High Electors know, and not a single one of them will point that out to him.
Would you?
With his talent strength? That would be dangerous, but they've all worked with him for years and years. With the shadow match conditioning, I don't think he can ask the right questions. And all those around him know it, and unless there's something else I don't know, they don't want to tell him what he doesn't want to hear.
Did you really expect it to be much different, dearest?
No. Not about them not wanting to tell him unpleasant news. But I had thought he could entertain the idea that the Master Scepter would not come to Corus.
Dainyl sighed, then offered a wry smile.
But it's clear he cannot even do that.
After a moment, he added,
I can't believe how much talent he has.
That's why he's Duarch. With the way everyone plots and schemes, No one without that kind of strength could survive. That certainly made sense.
Oh, I had another question. What do you know about the copper and tin mines around Supat? I'd always thought they were marginal.
Lystrana inclined her head, concentrating for a moment.
They're not the most productive, but there's been more demand for copper in the West from the engineers for work in Fatil. Why did you want to know?
One of Shastilt's last acts, while I was in Heolt, was to deploy a Cadmian battalion there to protect the mines against mountain brigands. There's nothing in the records to indicate why.
I don't know about that. I do know that Ruvrin was insistent that he needed more production, especially of copper.
Copper?
Dainyl didn't like that at all. Copper tended to be used more in crystal-based weapons, such as Myrmidon sidearms.
That makes the kind of sense I don't like.
Weapons and road-building equipment?
Dainyl nodded.
That only confirms what you already know about him.
All too true.
He paused.
Speaking about what I already know and can't bring to light, I'm going to go to Alistra tomorrow. I can't put that off any longer.
I worry about that, too.
Try not to. If not for yourself, for the little one.
Dainyl pulled on his robe and sat on the corner of the bed, facing her. Neither had lit the lamps, but with Alector's night vision, no lamps were necessary.
Are you certain that you want Alcina as submarshal here in Elsine?
Unfortunately, yes. What else can I do? Her official record is outstanding. She sent 7th Company to attack me and 5th Company in Heolt, but those orders were never put in writing, and the officers who received them are dead. Even if there were some documentary proof, she'd claimed that all she knew was that the regional elector was under attack.
In your command area,
Lystrana pointed out.
She'd already sent a protest about my actions, but she was clever enough to say that Shastilt sent me without justification, and Shastilt's dead.
You really want to deal with her on a daily basis?
I'd rather do that here than have her keep working with Brekilt in Alistra. By removing her...
But you'll have to promote Norian, and he's from Ifrin.
He's a bull and strong-willed, but he's not so devious. He'll do what Brekilt tells him, but what else can I do?
You can hope she'll attack you, or Brekilt will.
You have great confidence in my shields, dearest.
I do. But don't let your guard down, especially when they're not around.
Dainyl laughed, then eased up beside her. 4. An elector who wishes to be a responsible administrator must always keep in mind the difference between expectations based on facts and careful analysis and expectations based upon a desired outcome. All beings capable of some degree of thought speculate upon outcomes. Those that are most probable, those that are least probable, those that are most desired, and those that are least desired. A truly intelligent individual first gathers all facts and all manner of knowledge that may affect an outcome, even such knowledge of the sort that cannot be quantified in numerical or objective terms. Then the intelligent elector assesses that knowledge and constructs a probabilistic analysis of the possible outcomes, weighing all the factors on as objective a basis as possible. Subjective factors can and must be analyzed objectively, and this is one area where even the most rational of electors can mislead himself. Just because an elector does not allow excessive emotion to affect his choices and decisions, that does not mean that steers or less perceptive electors will not be affected by emotional factors. In addition, positive influences that cannot be quantified affect outcomes, such as a desire for excellence. Even when both objective and subjective components are factored into the assessment of an outcome, however, an elector who must make a decision may be influenced by the desire to see a particular outcome. Usually, this outcome influence results in the decision-maker weighing the component factors in such a fashion as to produce a prediction of the desired outcome. If the elector in question dislikes an outcome that will likely occur if subjective factors are weighted correctly, then the subjective factors will be dismissed or denigrated because they cannot be accurately quantified. In similar fashion, when quantifiable factors truly outweigh the subjective factors, the elector who favors a subjective-influenced outcome will tend to minimize the impacts of the quantifiable factors, often on the basis that beliefs or feelings have a stronger impact than can be accurately assessed. In the end, the judicious elector must work to assure that his expectations do not influence his analysis, but that accurate analysis and study form the basis for his expectations. Views of the Highest, Illustra, WT 1513. 5. Quatry morning found Mickle in what would be the quarters of the senior visiting Cadmean officer in the new compound. For now, he was that officer. Officially, Captain Kismer, the commanding officer of the 1st Healt Company, was the commander of the compound. Mickle's quarters were on the upper level of the main barracks, but at the rear. All the officers' quarters were accessed by an outside stairway. The space was empty, except for a bunk and a thin pallet mattress. The companies were scheduled to move from the old garrison to the new compound on Sexty, if all went well and the weather continued dry. Mickle would have liked to have moved everyone sooner, but the interior of the stables needed work, and he really wanted more of the courtyard paved. Mickle sat on the bunk, using a square of wood balanced on his knees as a writing desk, trying to complete the last few lines of his report to Colonel Harold. From through the open window, he could hear the sounds of clay being tamped in place, and rock chunks, gravel, and finally sand as a base for the redstone paving for the courtyard. Farther away was the rhythmic droning of a saw, cutting planks, or timbers, for the roofing of the headquarters building, the last structure in the compound to be completed. He'd made arrangements with Craftmaster Poulden for the stone paving of a narrow road from the compound to the high road, although most of that work beyond the area immediately outside the south gates would have to wait until the stonework in the compound was completed. Finally, Mickle put aside his makeshift desk and the completed report and stood. He still had to make a copy for his personal files, but the harder work of drafting a report that was complete, without disclosing matters that would create trouble for himself and without revealing that there were such omissions, was done. He had another day to make the copies he needed before the biweekly Sandoxen coach made its next trip through Healt. He walked to the half-open window and looked out. The barest breath of air wafted past him. For an early morning, late in harvest, it was already hot. Stindall was directing a windlass crew and a crane in placing the last of the roof beams on the headquarters building. Mickle nodded. He had to admit that the Healton crafters had done good work, better than he'd seen in a few places. But then, he reflected, Healt was a town that had come on hard times, and the workers were eager for work and good pay. His eyes lifted above the walls to the west, but he could not make out the regional elector's complex from the new compound, Not that there was much to see, according to Riston. Submarshal Dainyl's pterodons had flattened and burned the one outbuilding, and used some sort of fire to gut the interior of the tunnels and chambers cut into the rock of the cliff. Mickle took a deep breath and stretched, before heading for the door and down to the half-paved courtyard. Trorall, the head of the council in Hialt, as well as the largest cloth factor in the area, was due to arrive any moment to discuss the delivery of blankets and other needs for the compound. After that, Mickle needed to observe a drill involving both Hialtan companies. In a sense, the exercise was a formality. Both companies had performed well in the actions in Hialt and Tempra, although Second Company had seen more action in Tempra than First Company had in Hialt. Mickle had no more than stepped away from the barracks when Captain Kismer appeared and rode toward him.
"Good morning, Major. We stand ready for the exercise and evaluation."
"I'd guess about half a glass, Captain. Don't head out to the exercise area until then."
Mickle offered a wry smile. "I have to meet with Trorall first, about some supplies for you and your men, like blankets for the winter. Is there anything else you need beside what we went over yesterday?"
"No, sir. Matorak couldn't think of anything either."
"Good. At least, I hope that's good."
Mickle smiled. "If it's likely to be much longer than half a glass, I'll send a messenger. It's too hot for men and mounts to wait in the sun."
"Yes, sir."
Kismer turned and rode back toward the main gates. From what Mickle could sense, First Company had drawn up in the shade of the outside west walls. Mickle walked toward the headquarters building, staying well back, but watching as Stindall's crafters fastened the last of the roof beams in place. The telltale creaking alerted Mickle, and he turned and waited as a cart, pulled by a single horse, eased through the open main gates on the south side of the compound. Trorall drove the cart, which held a load piled high and covered by tarps carefully fastened in place. Blankets, no doubt. The factor eased the cart to a halt, short of the front of the new barracks. "Good morning, Trorall," Mickle called cheerfully as the factor climbed off his cart. Trorall finished tethering the leads to a stone post, not intended for that purpose, and walked toward Mickle. He stopped a good yard away.
"Good morning, Major."
Although the factor looked up at the taller lander, Trorall's eyes did not quite meet Mickle's.
"I see you brought the blankets."
"You did say you'd be wanting them once the barracks were done, and I heard that you'd be moving here in the next few days. That'd be telling me the barracks were done, or near enough."
Mickle caught, not with his eyes, but with his senses, feelings of absolute fear that even permeated the yellowish-brown aura of the Master Crafter. Was it still his reputation as a dagger of the ancients?
"Near enough. I'll write out the authorization. You'll have to draw the golds against the Cadmean letter of credit."
"I figured as much, what with you being in Tempra so long. True that you had to lay waste to the place."
Mickle laughed gently. "Not even close. We did kill a number of rebels, but there was only a little damage to one building. I doubt that most people even lost a copper or more than a little sleep."
"Said you wiped out companies and companies of the regional electors' mounted rifles."
Trorall's tone was dogged.
"We did wipe out three companies, but that fight took place outside Tempra."
"I figured you weren't the type to do that. Hurt folks not involved, I mean. But people were saying..."
"We didn't have much choice. They attacked us in the middle of the night."
That was a slight exaggeration. It had been two glasses before dawn, but Mickle didn't want to get into details.
"How have things been here?"
Trorol shook his head.
Weren't for you Cadmians, times would be terrible. After what those rebels did, be months, seasons maybe, before anyone will be able to sell anything to the regional elector again. Terrible mess out there.
Mikkel wondered if the Dewarches would even bother to replace the regional elector. And if so, when? I can see that will be a problem. He smiled politely. I do have a list of other goods that will be needing for the compound. Trorol did not look pleased, merely less unhappy. That didn't surprise Mikkel. In more than 2 seasons of working with the Factor, he'd never seen more than a momentary smile. Mikkel handed Trorol the list. If you could give me a bid in the next few days...
That I can do, Major. That I can.
Trorol folded the paper and tucked it away.
Now, where do you want the blankets?
In the barracks here, in the front bay for now.
For all the Factor's outward cheerfulness, Mikkel could still sense the man's fear. And it was clearly a fear of Mikkel. Yet Mikkel had never, ever threatened anyone in Hiolt, even indirectly. Mikkel had the feeling the day was going to be very long. 6. Dainyl had requested that Wyalt pick him up at the house with the duty coach at a glass before dawn. While he hated losing that much sleep, or causing the duty driver to do so, the sun rose a good 4 glasses earlier in Alestra, and leaving even as early as he planned would put him in Alestra in very late mid-morning. He still disliked using the duty coach to take him to and from his house, but at such early hours, since he'd neglected to make advance arrangements with his usual transport, the hacker Baradin, his choices were to use the duty coach or to walk. When Dainyl stepped out through the gates of his front courtyard on Quatry morning, he wore the traveling uniform of a Myrmidon officer, a blue flying jacket over a shimmer cloth tunic of brilliant blue, both above dark gray trousers with a heavy dark gray belt that held his light cutter sidearm. On his collar were the single green-edged gold stars of a marshal. Inside his uniform tunic were 2 envelopes, one containing Alcina's promotion to submarshal in Elsine, and the second containing Major Norian's appointment and promotion to submarshal in Alestra. Wyalt was waiting.
Good morning, Marshal. The Hall of Justice, sir.
There's nowhere else in Elsine I'd be headed this early.
Dainyl climbed into the coach. Wyalt swung the coach back around a side street and then turned west on the boulevard, the main thoroughfare that ran down the middle of the aisle from the bridge in the east to the gates at the Myrmidon compound at the west end of the aisle. As they passed the public gardens of the Dewarch, Dainyl glanced out, but in the pre-dawn darkness only the outlines of the elaborate topiary were visible, and the life-size pterodon looked to be next to the long hedge sculpted into the likeness of 2 sand oxen and a set of transport coaches, when in fact they were separated by a good 50 yards. Beyond the gardens were the Palace of the Dewarch on the south side of the boulevard, and the Hall of Justice on the north. The hall's golden eternastone glowed to Dainyl's talent, even in the darkness. Wyalt brought the coach to a smooth stop at the base of the wide golden marble steps of the Hall of Justice. After emerging from the coach and nodding to the driver, Dainyl hurried up the steps and through the golden stone pillars that marked the outer rim of the receiving rotunda. From there, he crossed the green and gold marble floor of the rotunda, the sound of his boots lost in the stillness before dawn. At a pillar beyond the dais where, later in the day, petitioners would assemble, he cloaked himself in a talent illusion, out of habit since no one was nearby. Then he turned the light torch bracket, and the solid stone shifted to one side, revealing an entry and a set of steps leading downward and lit by light torches. He closed the entry behind himself and made his way down the steps, turning right at the bottom to follow a stone-walled corridor. Before he reached the doorway to the table chamber on the north side, a sleepy-eyed young Elector appeared.
"Oh, Marshal, I had not heard you would be here so early. Let me tell the guards."
"Guards?"
"Yes, sir. We now have our own guards here. We've been getting too many wild translations, and more than a few renegades from Ifrin. Oh, when do you expect to return?"
"If all goes well, later today."
The aide to the High Elector stepped forward and released the hidden talent lock, then stepped into the foyer, lit by a single light torch. Before opening the second door, he called out, "It's Cartolin!" After speaking, he released the talent lock on the second door and stepped into the table chamber. Dainyl followed him, raising his talent shields. The table chamber walls were of white marble, the floor green. Two sets of double light torches set 5 yards apart in bronze brackets on the side walls provided the sole illumination to the underground chamber. Unlike other table chambers, there were no furnishings at all. The table itself looked like any other table, a square, polished stone pedestal in the center of the room that extended a yard above the stone floor. The stone appeared black on the side, but the top surface was mirror-like silver. Each side of the table-like pedestal was 3 yards. The other aspect of the table, perceived only through talent, was the purple glow that emanated from it. 2 guards in dark purple sat on stools beside the doorway, facing the table. Each carried a light-cutter sidearm. Dainyl recognized one of them, a former Myrmidon who had served 50 years before requesting a stipend.
"Marshal, sir, congratulations."
"Thank you, Traegerit. Have you had any problems on this watch?"
"No, sir. Had a wild translation yesterday. Vritist had to cut down a fellow with a Myrmidon guard blade on Duadi."
Dainyl shook his head.
"I'll be back later today. I'd appreciate your being a bit careful."
Never before in the history of Corus had guards been stationed, or necessary, inside a table chamber. Even before now, Dainyl had not taken table travel casually, not when some of the recorders of deeds had backed Brekhild and tried to create fatal accidents for Dainyl when he had been translating. Now he also had to worry about emerging from a translation and being accidentally shot if he did not maintain talent shields every moment. With a smile at the guards, Dainyl stepped up onto the table, immediately concentrating through his talent on the darkness beneath and within the table. He dropped through the silvered surface and into the intense chill of purplish blackness that permeated every span of his body, despite his uniform and flying jacket. Although he saw, not with his eyes, but his talent, he extended his senses toward the dark gray locator, bordered in purple, that identified Alestra. He ignored the stronger and closer locators of Tempra, bright blue, and the crimson gold of Derica, instead pressing himself toward the more distant wedge of dark gray. Other locators swirled by, wedges of amber, brilliant yellow, green, gray. Well beyond stretched a distant purple-black wedge, the long translation tube back to Ifrin, the tube that all too many Ifrits were bribing and forcing their way into, knowing that Ifrin was dying and that there was too little time remaining. With the usual suddenness that ended all translations, the silver barrier seemed to flash toward Dainyl, hurling him through it. Dainyl stood on yet another table in another windowless chamber. He had made the translation so swiftly that only the slightest hint of frost had appeared on his flying jacket and uniform before vanishing. Dainyl held his talent shields, but the pair of guards in black and silver uniforms waiting and watching did not even move as he descended from the table. Unlike the table chamber in Elsine, a set of black and silver bordered hangings adorned the walls, and each hanging contained a scene featuring an Alector. A long, black chest stood against the wall opposite the single entrance, a square arch in which a solid oak door was set, and on each side of which sat a guard. A younger Alector in the purple-trimmed green of a recorder of deeds stepped forward.
"Marshal Dainyl, welcome to Alastra. We had not expected you, but you are more than welcome any time. I am Retil, Zorator's successor."
Behind Retil's modest shields lay apprehension.
"Thank you, Retil."
Dainyl smiled politely.
"I appreciate your thoughtfulness. As a dutiful recorder, I'm more than certain that you will do your best to maintain the stability of the grid, unlike the late recorder in Heolt."
"Absolutely, sir."
Dainyl could read the consternation behind the calm expression on Retil's face, but only continued to smile as he walked to the chamber door. On each side of the arch in the hallway outside were another pair of Alectors, also wearing black and silver uniforms. They did not speak as Dainyl departed, walking to the end of the corridor and up the stairs to the main level. From there, he took the main corridor leading to the west portico. The passageway was floored in a shimmering silver-gray marble, the octagonal tiles outlined with thin strips of black marble. Silver and black bordered hangings decorated the walls. The portico was not paved in marble, but white granite, and the columns were smooth, circular, white granite pillars. Dainyl had not expected a duty coach to be waiting, and, indeed, one was not. While he waited, he occasionally looked at the residence and headquarters of the High Elector of the East. It was a long and solid white granite structure with three stories showing above ground level and two wings angling from the central rectangular core, and the stone sparkled in the late morning sun. He also looked at the cloudy sky, hoping that it didn't rain before he found transportation. He had to wait a quarter of a glass before a free hack arrived, but the indigent driver was more than pleased.
"The Myrmidon compound? Yes, sir. Be half a silver."
"That's fine."
Dainyl swung up into the coach. As the coach carried him away from the park-like ground surrounding the residence and along the divided boulevard that ran from the hilltop residence overlooking Alastra itself to the ring road that encircled the main sections of the city, Dainyl considered what lay ahead of him. Alcina was supposed to be in Alastra, but whether she was or not, that was another question. Still, the last thing he would have wanted to do was to announce when he was arriving. After a time, he looked out at Alastra, a city far more spread out than either Elsine or Ludar. The sole compact area was around the wharves, packed with warehouses and factorages. Most of Alastra stretched east of the river and north of Fiera Sound. The walled eastern Myrmidon headquarters dominated the larger bluff east of the city proper and overlooked both the river and the ocean. But the driver pulled up outside the gates, since no non-electors were permitted within. Dainyl got out, handed the driver a half silver and three coppers, and walked through the unguarded gates toward the headquarters building, also constructed of perfectly cut and fitted white granite, with blackish-green roof tiles. The duty officer bolted into the entry corridor within moments after Dainyl stepped through the arched doorway into the building.
Marshal Dainyl.
There was a long pause.
So, no one knew.
Dainyl had met her before, but her name escaped him.
No one was supposed to know.
He smiled politely.
Is the submarshal in? In her study?
Yes, sir.
Good. Thank you.
With that, holding full talent shields, he turned down the corridor, his boots clicking faintly on the green marble, and walked to the very end of the hallway where he stepped through the open door into Alcina's study, a space a good third larger than his spaces as marshal in Elsine. As before, not that he would have expected any change, the walls were bare except for a single depiction of the city of Alastra, in black ink on white paper and framed in black and silver. Alcina glanced up from the wide ebony table desk and froze, if for only a moment. Then she laughed.
Marshal, you have just demonstrated why you succeeded Shastilt.
Dainyl had to admire her recovery. He doubted that he could possibly have made such a rapid adjustment.
And you have proved why my trip here is both worthwhile and necessary.
He gestured at the circular ebony conference table, with five wooden armchairs set around it, all finished in silver.
If you would join me.
Alcina rose gracefully from behind the table desk.
How could I refuse such a request?
Dainyl seated himself so that he had a view of both the sound through the wide south window and of the still open door.
I believe I said this before, but you do have a lovely view of the sound.
It is lovely.
Alcina took the other side of the table, from where she could watch him and the doorway as well.
Might I ask why you are here, sir?
To offer you your due, as submarshal in Elsine, and as my designated successor.
Marshal Dainyl, you're more devious than Shastilt.
She laughed, and her laugh remained warm, so at odds with the coldness he sensed within her.
And I thought you were so simple.
I'm very simple, Alcina. I don't want you plotting against me. The best way to assure that is to give you what you want. You want power. You also want some assurance that you won't be removed or cast aside. I'm the most trustworthy elector you'll ever find, so long as you don't plot against me.
He shrugged.
You're also extremely good at organization and delegation. There isn't anyone better left in the Myrmidons. I need that excellence. Despite the situation here, you can do better, and with less risk.
Alcina just looked at Dainyl. He let her talent probes wash over him. Abruptly, she straightened slightly in her chair.
How did you manage Heolt?
As well as I could.
Seventh Company, I meant.
Simple. I took out Veluara, and then Clind, and then Weltak, and disarmed Lysitar and threatened to take them all out one at a time.
As a passenger?
No. Once Relin's men killed one of the Fifth Company Myrmidons, I took it.
A high elector flying and leading a company. I doubt that's ever happened.
There wasn't much choice if I wanted to stop Myrmidon from fighting Myrmidon.
If I accepted the position in Elsine, who would you name as submarshal here?
I'd thought Norian. Do you have a better idea?
Alcina nodded slowly.
Why are you doing this?
I told you.
There's more.
There is. Ifrin is far closer to collapse than people know. Without a united Myrmidon command, matters will be far worse. Personal allegiances will change like the wind as one High Elector or another finds his allies have other needs.
Do you trust Zeliert?
Dainyl had considered that, long and hard, but what he felt wasn't necessarily what he wanted to answer.
He is my superior. So long as he follows the code and his responsibilities as High Elector of Justice, I see no reason not to trust him.
Sir, that's scarcely an enthusiastic endorsement.
I find, Alcina, that I have become far less enthusiastic in recent times.
When do you want me in Elsine?
Tomorrow, or as soon after as you can manage.
Dainyl withdrew the envelope with her name written on it.
Here is your appointment.
He took out the second envelope.
Here is Norian's. If you would tender it to him, I do not intend to remain long in Alastra, and he owes the appointment to your training and supervision.
What would you have done if I had declined?
Torn them up.
I should be able to manage arriving in Elsine by next Duardi. It will take a few days to brief Norian, especially since he will have to fly here from Nordar.
Dainyl smiled.
Is Brekild here in Alastra?
He actually is. He hasn't been using the tables as much recently. You seem to be one of the few High Electors who is unworried by all the instability. Do you plan to see him?
I had thought to convey your promotion and that of Major Norian to him personally.
You think he will react in a way similar to Kelbrit?
Alcina's words were casual.
One never knows, but I'd be most surprised.
We can walk out, and I'll make sure Under Captain Brian Dar summons the duty coach.
She's from Ifrin too, isn't she?
Of course. As you are discovering, Acorus has too small a number of electors to supply the intelligence and ambition for all the leadership needs.
Alcina stood.
I can see that, but how could you be sure that you got the best from Ifrin?
Dainyl rose, his attention on her.
I can't answer that, sir, but if I had to speculate, I'd guess that the worst were sent to other duties and locales.
Dainyl held in a shudder. Alcina and Brekild had basically culled the survivors of the unauthorized translations from Ifrin, taking the best for the Myrmidons and sending the others to Hialt and Dulca as disposable troops. And Dainyl had conveniently disposed of half of them.
How else would things have worked out as they did?
She asked.
It did force Zeliert and Kellerit to accept your abilities, and that wouldn't have happened otherwise.
They didn't have any choices left,
Dainyl replied.
Shastild was trying to blame you and me for staging a coup. I think he may even have contacted Brekild.
For another brief moment, something too quick to identify flashed behind Alcina's shields. She spoke quickly, but softly.
Your meeting with Brekild will be interesting.
She walked toward the doorway and the corridor beyond. Dainyl joined her, and the two walked without speaking for a moment, as Alcina gestured to Under-Captain Briandaw, who smiled and nodded back.
Briandaw already has the duty coach waiting for you.
As with so many of your officers, she's perceptive.
Now that Denner has departed, I imagine yours in the West are also perceptive.
That could be. Brekild will be relieved to see you come to Elsine, I suspect,
offered Dainyl as they neared the entry foyer.
He may at that, or he may surprise you.
I'm rarely surprised,
Dainyl said wryly.
I don't know enough to create expectations, and surprise comes from having one's expectations upset.
That may be one of your great strengths, Marshal, because it is so rare among electors.
The illusion of elector impartiality,
he said with a laugh, stepping through the archway and out toward the duty coach. He did not recognize the driver. Grannon had already become a flyer, and perhaps Olyssa had as well. He stopped short of the coach and turned.
I'll expect you on Septi.
Yes, sir. I'll be there.
Dainyl could sense, perhaps for the first time in dealing with Alcina, what amounted to a feeling of respect. That worried him more than her past attitude of near contempt, because it suggested matters were even worse than he'd thought. He nodded and stepped up into the coach. On the ride back to the Eastern residence, he considered the possibilities for dealing with Breckhilt, but the only one that made sense was the polite and direct approach. Dainyl had never been good at intrigue and playing people off against each other, and now was no time to start. Dainyl stepped out of the carriage on the upper drive of the residence.
"Marshal, sir, would you like me to wait?"
asked the driver.
"No, thank you."
One way or another, it wouldn't be necessary. He turned toward the entrance, noting that one of the guards in black and silver had vanished, but that mystery resolved itself when the guard reappeared, almost instantly, with an electress. Dainyl had never seen her, but the darker, purple sheen of her aura told him, all too clearly, that she was a recent arrival from Ifrin, despite her shimmering silver and black uniform.
"Is the High Elector expecting you, Marshal?"
She bowed deferentially.
"I'm certain that he is not, but then I could be wrong."
Dainyl laughed politely.
"He will wish to see me."
"Yes, sir. I have no doubts about that. If you will follow me, he is in his study."
Dainyl walked beside the Electress along the colonnade and past two lander guards in black and silver stationed before the vaulted archway. The guard on the left opened one of the double doors for the two. As Dainyl recalled, she continued through a high-ceilinged entry hall that held black marble columns spaced at 4-yard intervals along the white walls. The floor of the entry hall was composed of black octagons set in white granite. Beyond the entry hall, the corridor narrowed, and at the end was another set of golden oak double doors, guarded by a young electress in the black and silver.
"Coraman, if you will inform the High Elector that Marshal Dainyl is here."
"One moment, Marshal, if you will."
The guard slipped through the door, returning within moments.
"The High Elector will be pleased to see you immediately."
She held the door open. Dainyl walked through the door alone, seeking anything untoward with his talent senses and raising full talent shields. He took the archway to the right and the next hallway to the first doorway on the left. The door to Breckhilt's study was open, and Dainyl entered. The inner wall of the study was lined with shelves of books, while the shelves on the outer wall were limited to narrow stretches between the floor-to-ceiling windows, except in the middle of the wall, where there was a set of open double doors. Breckhilt sat behind the table desk before the full wall of books and gestured to the two armchairs in front of his desk.
"Please do have a seat, Marshal."
"Thank you."
Dainyl eased into the armchair on the left.
"What brings you to Alastra? Certainly not your health."
Breckhilt's wide and expressive mouth offered a wry expression that was not quite a smile.
"Myrmidon matters. I find that I have little time for anything else."
"Ah, yes. When are you planning to return 7th's company to Dulka?
Not for a while. There appears to be a need for the Myrmidons in Tempera.
I must congratulate you on your handling of that minor uprising in Hiolt.
Thank you.
I don't believe you mentioned why you were here.
Since I was in Alastair on other matters, I thought I would pay a courtesy call on the Elector of the East. It seemed only fitting.
Dainyl, said Brekelt with a single laugh. You do nothing without purpose.
That might be your greatest weakness. I am certain that I have others.
Dainyl offered a faint smile in return.
As you may know, there is currently no submarshal of Myrmidons in Elsine, since the most able and qualified individual for that position is here in Alastra. I came here to offer the position to her, and I am fortunate that she agreed to accept. Norian will replace her as submarshal here.
Only the slightest hint of a pause suggested any thought considered by Brekhilt.
That is interesting.
Necessary, as I am sure that you understand. It's similar, in a fashion, to gardening.
I'm certain you had hoped that I would attempt something foolish, Marshal.
I assure you that I will not.
At my advanced age, one learns which battles to fight. And I will leave you to fight those you must.
He smiled.
Now that you are Marshal, you will find there are more than you ever believed possible.
That is something I've already discovered.
Do you really think you can manage Alcina?
No. I have never had that illusion.
Then why?
I need excellence even more than loyalty, Brekhilt. Especially in these times.
You will pay a high price for that excellence.
Excellence always has a high price, as does everything of value, according to what I have seen, as well as the views of the highest.
What Dainyl didn't say was that the price for not paying for excellence, in some fashion, was even higher.
You quote the Archon well, Marshal.
It is a useful skill.
Dainyl smiled and inclined his head.
I had not meant to take any more of your time, but I did not wish for you to find out about these changes in the Myrmidons from anyone else.
I do appreciate your courtesy, Dainyl, and you are always welcome in Alastra.
Thank you.
Dainyl stood and bowed slightly. He held his shields at full strength all the way back down to the table chamber. 7. Retil bowed as Dainyl stepped into the table chamber in Alastra.
Marshal, we wish you the best.
Dainyl doubted that, but he only smiled as he stepped up onto the table.
Thank you.
While he wanted to get back to Elsine quickly, he held his shields, even as he concentrated, and slipped through the table and into the blackness beneath, where he found himself in a turbulence that he'd never encountered before. The entire translation tube felt as though it were undulating its entire unmeasurable length, rippling from a nexus of green somewhere beyond the tube and near, yet lost in the distance. For all that, the blackness beneath the purple darkness of the tube seemed unmoving. Whatever was happening had to be the doing of the ancients, somehow and in some fashion. For a long moment, Dainyl did not even seek out the brilliant white locator of Elsine. Then, he reached out with talent, but found the seemingly shifting nature of the tube made concentrating on the locator difficult. His talent probe vanished as if he had never extended it.
He tried again, conscious of the chill seeping into him. But just as his probe seemed to touch the locator, the tube twisted. Dainyl jabbed quickly a third time and linked with the El-Seen locator. Even so, he felt as though he tumbled through the rapids of an unseen river before he flew through the silver-white barrier. He avoided stumbling over his boots as he emerged on the table at El-Seen, but staggered in trying to regain his balance. Both guards had their weapons aimed, and Dainyl strengthened his shields before even completely recovering his balance.
No, it's the Marshal!
Chastil looked up at him from the end of the table. Dainyl jumped off the table and stood beside the recorder of deeds.
What's happening with the tables?
I don't know, sir. Everything... it's strange. We've had 3 wild translations in the last glass, and the whole grid... it was pulsing.
The recorder extended a talent pulse into the table.
It peaked a little while ago, and it's beginning to subside.
Do you know what caused it?
While Dainyl certainly had his own ideas, he wanted to know what Chastil thought. Dainyl had the feeling that Retil had known there was some sort of difficulty and had refrained from warning him.
No, sir. It just... happened.
Has anything like this happened before?
I don't know of anything like that. It might be because the tables in Tempra and Heald haven't been repaired yet.
Dainyl didn't know what else to say about the translation tube.
Thank you for warning the guards not to shoot me.
Oh, you're welcome.
Dainyl nodded and turned toward the door. He noted that there were now no talent locks in place, and that made sense given the guards inside the table chamber. He was halfway down the corridor to the steps up to the open section of the Hall of Justice when Zelliard stepped out of his private study.
Dainyl, a moment of your time, if you would.
Yes, sir.
Dainyl turned and headed into the High Elector's study, one of the more Spartan he had ever seen, with little more than an ebony table, 2 chairs, and 2 bookcases, all lit by light torches on the windowless stone walls. He closed the door. Zelliard seated himself and motioned to the other chair. Dainyl took it and waited.
I heard from Kellerit that you were impressive in your briefings and successful in conveying a veiled message to High Elector Ruvrin.
I doubt it was that veiled.
That is not of the matter. He will report what happened to Samist. How did your visit to the Submarshal in Alastra go?
I offered her the position as Submarshal here in El-Seen. She had several questions, but after I answered them, she accepted.
What did you promise her?
Nothing. I did mention that Shastilt had told me that she and I were planning a coup.
So she is aware that Brekilt intended to betray her to save himself, if necessary?
She was doubtless aware of that all along. Brekilt was her only way to power. I have offered her a way that seems less fraught with danger.
You phrase that in an interesting manner, Dainyl.
Dainyl shook his head slightly.
Any way to power is dangerous.
Zelliard smiled faintly.
Now that you have dealt with the difficulties in Alastra, I would trust you will not be away from El-Seen so much.
Dainyl smiled politely.
That will depend, sir, on what future difficulties arise.
You will have a submarshal.
That is true, and Alcina is a superb administrator.
Zelliard offered a smile even more faint than the last.
You intend to continue to travel?
Only as necessary, sir. I have little love of travel for the sake of travel, nor do I like spending time away from my wife.
How did Brekhild take your visit?
He intimated that I would have great difficulties in controlling Alcina. He said he would not do me the favor of attempting to attack me, and that I would learn which battles to fight and which to avoid.
He has always operated in such a fashion,
replied Zelliert.
How did you respond?
I told him that was something I had begun to discover.
What do you think he believes about Alcina?
That she will cause us great difficulty, and that will make his efforts to gain control of the east of Corus that much easier.
You are assuming a great deal, Dainyl, and not wisely.
I do not believe it is unwise to assume that Brekhild seeks power. He has attempted to control or suborn the recorders and regional electors in the east, as well as a few in the west. His actions indicate that he is clearly of the opinion that the Master Scepter will go to Ephra and not come to Acorus, and that the Duarches will be unable to rule as they have. I am not assuming he will be successful in his efforts, but to disregard what he has done and the implications behind those actions would also be unwise.
You suggest an unlikely set of probabilities.
Dainyl did not think so, but he smiled.
Brekhild's motivations come from seeking power. I defer to you in his likelihood of success, but that probable lack of success does not mean he will not create great difficulties in the near future, and I would prefer to be prepared for whatever efforts he may undertake, or cause others to undertake.
Being prepared for such efforts is wise, so long as it does not take excessive resources.
I believe I understand that as well, sir.
So long as you do.
Zelliert stood.
I wish you the best, Marshal.
Dainyl rose easily, but not abruptly.
Thank you.
And, Dainyl, remember that even the most able of indigens and landers are only steers, to be used as necessary.
Yes, sir.
Dainyl could feel Zelliert's eyes on his back as he left the High Elector's study. Outside, on the boulevard on the south side of the Hall of Justice, Dainyl managed to find a free hacker in less than a tenth of a glass. When he returned to headquarters, he was pleasantly surprised to find a complete proposed schedule for both 1st and 7th companies for the next month, with a cover note from Under-Captain Zernaltaw, politely requesting his review and any suggestions for improvement, since she had not prepared a report for him before. He read through the schedule and made a note to tell her about the need for a designated standby on Decty in case the duty flyer was sent on a long run, and the need to schedule transport for the table engineers from Fatal to Hialt. She had also attached the latest report from Colonel Harold on the 1st Cadmian Regiment, with a written question as to whether he wanted the reports forwarded to him with any comments she might have, or without comment. Dainyl shook his head. Denner had never even considered written comments. Dainyl would have to see how she handled other matters, but from what he was seeing, Zernaltaw was well suited to handling operations and scheduling. He picked up Colonel Harold's report and began to read. For all the battalions, except 4th Battalion, little had changed. All but 2nd Battalion were under strength, but no significant new casualties had been reported. On the other hand, with the reporting delays, Dainyl probably knew more about what had recently happened with 3rd Battalion than did the Colonel. He concentrated on the 4th Battalion report.
4th Battalion, Major Hersiod commanding, is currently deployed to Ironstem, based out of the Cadmian compound there. In the last few weeks of summer and early harvest, the battalion has encountered increasing attacks from irregulars believed to be Raelys, and from packs of the large predators termed sand wolves by the locals. Limited injuries have also occurred from several horned creatures similar to sheep. Despite increasing casualties, the battalion continues to provide support to the local Cadmian forces in maintaining order at the iron and coal mines and the ironworks.
Dainyl shook his head. What was it about Ironstem and the Iron Valleys? For 2 years, the place had created problem after problem. Now, another new creature? Should he send a squad from First Company? Perhaps under Captain Chelistaw and Fourth Squad. Gasshilt had certainly recommended her highly enough. If more support were needed, he might be able to detach a squad from 7th Company in Tempra, although Captain Lysatah was operating at close to 20% under strength. He needed to send a message to a Sulet in Liturna. As the senior elector in charge of lifeform management, a Sulet might be able to provide more information. And, in addition to the problems in Ironstem, Dainyl still had no idea what was happening in Supat. 8. In the darkness a good glass after sunset, Mickle walked slowly uphill, away from the old garrison that 3rd Battalion and the two Hialton Cadmian companies had used for the past 2 seasons, and would be leaving permanently in the morning. The night was dark, because Selina, the brighter moon, had already set in the west, and the smaller green moon, Astarta, was but a crescent in the east. Even so, Mickle had little trouble navigating through the darkness that seemed little more than early twilight with the night vision that had accompanied the development of his talent. Just short of the jumble of rocks, where so much had happened over the last season, Mickle halted. There were no ancient Soarers around, and he hadn't expected any. He certainly hadn't sensed them, but they had appeared to him a number of times, and only in particular places, always on hills. There had to be some reason why the Soarers had appeared on this particular hill, and nowhere else around Hialt, at least not that he knew. When he had finally connected himself to the world where he was, and not from where he had been born, he had sensed a certain darkness that lay beneath. But did that lie beneath all the earth? Or just beneath the hillside? He stood in the night, looking westward, letting his senses extend from him, especially trying to feel what lay beneath. In time, he began to sense the blackness he sought, almost like a river or a high road, well beneath the surface of the ground, arrowing westward from where he stood toward the battered and half-destroyed compound of the regional elector. He could also sense his own life thread extending downward through the very soil and rocks into that blackness. There might have been a few streaks of purple as well. He concentrated, and the blackness vanished. After forcing himself to relax, to experience everything around him, he once more began to gather in the blackness beneath, as well as something else, a line of purplish mist that lay right above the darkness. Slowly, he turned until he faced the garrison, looking eastward. To the east, the blackness angled more deeply into the earth, until his senses could trace it no farther. He turned back to the west until he looked into the night, once more in the direction of the regional elector's compound. The purple mist had something to do with the electors. Perhaps their tables? He shook his head. If he had studied the table in Tempra more closely, he might well have a better idea. But he had not. After another quarter glass or so, he began to walk down the gentle slope, back toward the garrison. Riston was waiting outside the west gate.
Major?
It's me, Riston.
Who else would it be at this time of night?
You worried that I might get hit by Alectors lightning again?
Mickle chuckled.
When you go off in the night, it's not always good.
Riston shook his head. I needed to get away to think. The captain laughed softly.
I can barely see, and you're walking around as if it were broad daylight.
I've always had good night vision. You know that.
You have lots of talent, sir. Could be that you have too many.
Mickle understood what Riston meant. What am I supposed to do? Let my men die because captains, or majors, shouldn't do certain things?
In some ways, Major, I'm glad that I don't have to make those choices.
There was a silence.
Fabritol said that Celtier's daughter helped nurse you back. How did she get to Tempera?
Women in drama can't inherit. Her brothers died, and Vaclan killed her father. Her cousin got the lands. She was sent to Southgate to her mother's brother or cousin, and he sent her to run his nephew's household in Tempera, at least until he finds a wife. I'd asked her for some information, and Fabritol pressured her into taking care of me. He worried about me being unconscious too close to the regional elector's headquarters.
That was smart of him. But how did he get her to agree?
I don't know. Mickle laughed. I wasn't awake enough to listen.
Seems sort of strange, the way she keeps turning up.
More than a little, but sometimes things happen that way.
Mickle didn't believe that for a moment. All he knew was that, in some fashion, he and Rachelar were linked. But he couldn't have explained why or how.
Which way do you think the Colonel will send us?
Asked Riston.
Back to Norther, I mean.
I'm not sure he will, replied Mickle. 6th Battalion was sent to Supat. 4th Battalion is still in Ironstem, and 5th is up north dealing with Rayleighs. Troubles seem to be happening faster than they can be put down.
That's true, but it doesn't make sense.
It might, if we knew more, Mickle admitted. But no one tells Cadmean majors and captains that much.
Not until they've fouled up and want us to fix things.
Mickle agreed with that, too. He only wondered what else was likely to go wrong. Or already had. 9. Quatre had been a very long day for Dainyl, and he was more than glad to retire with Lystrana to their bedchamber almost immediately after the evening meal. He'd undressed and pulled on a robe. Lystrana stretched out on the smooth, white cotton spread that covered the deep blue wool blankets, propped up against the headboard by 3 pillows. Even sitting on the high stool away from the foot of the bed, Dainyl could sense the separate essences of both Lystrana and Kytra'a.
You still have some of that greenish force around your shoulder, Lystrana mused. It's as if it's diluting itself through you, rather than fading away.
I'm turning green?
Just a faint tinge. Most people won't sense it. Do you think that it's just the result of your wound, or something the ancients did?
Both, I think.
He shook his head.
I wouldn't have survived without their aid.
Why would they want to help you? Do you think it's some sort of subterfuge?
Dainyl frowned.
Some sort of talent-spread illness that will infect others? Do I feel ill or unhealthy? To you, I mean. I certainly don't feel that way.
Her forehead furrowed. After a moment, she replied.
You seem strong and healthy, but I don't understand why they would help you.
They said that they owed us a debt for saving the world.
but that if we did not change, we would destroy it. The old one also said that the sword with which Relin wounded me was their responsibility, and that I would have died had I not reached them.
They do not use tables either, do they?
They have the mirrors, but they seem to be able to translate to other places where there are no mirrors.
Lystranar tilted her head.
Do you think we could?
The only times I've managed anything like that, I had to use counterfeit, in a sense. Their greenish talent.
I don't like that.
I didn't either.
No,
she said slowly.
I meant that it suggests there is something more powerful about their talent.
There is. Shastilt and Asulit both noted that the ancients were the only force able to destroy pteridons.
Dainyl chuckled wryly.
Light cannon will as well.
You're tired.
The translation back from Alastra was hard. I think it was because the ancients were doing something. The entire translation tube was undulating, like you might do to a heavy rope or a cable if you whipped it up from one end. Chastil said that they'd received 3 wild translations, and one of the guards in the table chamber in the Hall of Justice was ready to cut me down.
Guards in the table chambers? Here on Acorus?
Lystranar frowned.
It's something that the recorders are doing now, over the past few days. All sorts of translations are arriving from Ifrin.
That sounds like Ifrin is collapsing, or close to it, and that the ancients know it and are preparing to attack in some way. If they keep doing that to the tubes, not many will translate successfully from Ifrin here. Guards in the table chambers.
Her frown was far more expressive than any headshake could have been.
I couldn't prove it.
Dainyl stretched, stifling a yawn.
But I think the ancients' power is limited. Their technique with the green talent is better, but there can't be that many of them.
There aren't that many of us,
she pointed out.
And there won't be many more if the ancients keep the successful translations low. Do you think you should tell Asulit, or the Dew Arches?
How can I tell them much? I can mention the sense of greenness in the last translation to Asulit. I've already sent him a message about another new creature around Ironstem, so I may have a reason to go to Litana before long. But if I say much more, then I risk being destroyed because I haven't been truthful. I couldn't tell Shastilt everything. He would have used it against me.
So would Zeliot,
added Lystranar sadly. A quizzical expression followed.
What new creature?
I don't know, except the Cadmean reports say that it is horned and similar to sheep, and that it's caused casualties. And that's not like any sheep I ever heard of.
Doesn't it strike you as strange that all of this is happening now?
Strange? No. It's predictable. We're likely to be more vulnerable, at least during the transfer of the Master Scepter, and the ancients have to know that more Alectors are coming to Acorus. There's been a rebellion and unrest as Alectors seek to change who holds power on Acorus. At the same time, we've seen new predators or a resurgence of old ones and greater efforts by the ancients against the pteridons. To me, it all follows. They'll strike at us now because we're not really unified and because, if they don't, we will get stronger and wipe them out.
And yet they saved you.
When Lystranar put it that way, Dainyl didn't care for the implications at all. Had he somehow, even without his own knowledge, been subverted to the goals and desires of the ancients? And if he had not, why had they not only spared him when he'd been in their power, but actually saved him? He stifled another yawn.
Dearest, You need some sleep. It will all make more sense when you're rested.
She was right about his needing sleep, but Dainyl had the feeling that what the ancients had in mind would not be any clearer in the morning, or, indeed, at any time, until it was too late for him to do anything about matters. 10. With all the details and difficulties involved in moving 3rd Battalion from the old Hialt garrison to the new compound north of the town, it was the following Lundi before Mikkel felt matters were settled enough for him to take Fabrital and 15th Company on an armed reconnaissance of the half-destroyed regional Alectors complex in Hialt. He had wanted to get there before the Alectors returned, but not before he had the companies relocated in a more defensible position. Still, as of Dekdi evening, the squads maintaining the security perimeter around the area had not reported any activity. Mikkel had not seen any reason to take the more circular patrol route to the north. Instead, he had ordered the company along the main route to the compound. For the first vaunt away from the square in Hialt, the way was paved, but after that, it deteriorated to a packed clay and gravel road that circled around low hills covered with the brush and junipers that seemed ubiquitous west of Hialt. The road was wide enough for easy travel with two mounts abreast, and hard-packed enough that where ruts existed, they were shallow. Despite the haze that created an even greater silver sheen across the otherwise cloudless green sky, the morning sun was warm on the back of Mikkel's gray and maroon cadmium uniform tunic. He shifted his weight in the saddle, gingerly, in order not to jolt his still tender shoulder.
"You think we'll see any strange creatures, Major?"
Fabrital rode to Mikkel's right.
"These days, I'm not certain what we'll see or where we'll encounter it. We might see anything. And we might run into nothing."
Mikkel glanced ahead, his eyes on the scouts a good half-vaunt out, moving out of sight where the road curved south and then west again. He did not sense anything untoward, but he had not forgotten there were some Alectors and Landers that he could not sense. His lips curled into a faint smile. One of those was Rachela. That should not have surprised him, but at the time he had discovered that, it had. He felt that there was so much more to her than he could sense. Less than a glass later, a half-squad of Cadmians appeared on the road, formed up and apparently waiting for Mikkel and 15th Company. Once they neared the patrol squad, Fabrital halted 15th Company, and the two officers rode forward to the Cadmian in charge.
"Major, sir, no intruders sighted this watch."
The squad leader was from 1st Hialt Company, and Mikkel did not recall the man's name.
"Any sign of anyone in the compound?"
"No, sir."
"We're going in to take a closer look. I'd appreciate it if you'd continue your patrols. If you see anything strange, or any pteridons flying in, send a messenger."
"Yes, sir."
The squad leader nodded emphatically.
"Thank you."
Mikkel eased his mount westward.
15th Company, forward!"
ordered Fabrital. Neither officer spoke as they rode away from the patrol and led 15th Company up the last section of the road, a long, gentle slope, at the end of which Mikkel could see the red stone cliffs that held part of the compound. The packed dirt and clay of the road had turned a redder shade, and there was more sand in the loose dust and dirt, and more space between the clumps of harvest-tan grass. The wind had picked up, hot and dry out of the south, carrying fine dust that stuck to the sweat on the back of Mikkel's neck.
"Why do you think they haven't sent anyone to repair things here?"
asked Fabrital. "I imagine temper is a higher priority. It takes longer to transport men and materials here. They've all got to come by the high roads. It's close to 700 vonts by road from Fatel to Heolt. That's after they decide how they want to rebuild.
If they want to.
They will, predicted Mikkel. There had to be some reason why the Electors had built in Heolt in the first place. He just didn't know what it happened to be. When 15th Company reached the level section of ground that stretched eastward from the line of cliffs, Mikkel studied the area with both his eyes and other senses. What remained of the outbuilding was a heap of redstone, discolored by soot and ashes. A stone archway and recessed entry provided the access to whatever chambers and passages had been cut into the redstone cliff. Higher up, he could see scorched and blackened patches.
"Burned it good,"
murmured Fabrital. "I don't think they had much choice. How else do you get people out of a stone redoubt without losing all sorts of men?
They don't mind losing our men."
"Some don't, and some do. The Submarshal doesn't like wasting men. He kept the Cadmeans here out of the direct fighting, and he ordered us not to deal with the rebel Electors in Tempra directly unless absolutely necessary."
"Major, sir, he's about the only one I ever heard who thinks that way."
"You may be right. We'd better hope nothing happens to him." As they drew nearer to the ruined outbuilding, Mikkel could make out black lines across the sandy soil, and there was still the faintest odor of smoke and burned wood. Although he saw no bodies and no crows or other carrion eaters, a sense of death permeated everything. Mikkel reined up a good 20 yards from the stone archway that framed the recessed entry into the cliff. Smoke had stained the stone, and a faint odor of brimstone lingered. "I'll want to inspect the tunnels."
"Yes, sir. I'll send a squad out first, just in case."
Fabrital turned in the saddle.
"First squad, dismount! Rifles ready! Second squad, take their mounts!"
Mikkel did not protest. From what he could sense, there was no one present. Even if there might be someone undetected by his talent, that was infrequent, and a single individual could only inflict limited damage.
"First squad, check out the chambers and report!"
Fabrital rode to the side.
"Fifth squad, rifles ready, watch for intruders!"
Then he rode back and reined up beside Mikkel. As they waited, Mikkel kept his senses alert, but could only detect Cadmeans.
"Do you have any idea why the Electors here rebelled against the Myrmidons, sir?"
Fabrital finally asked.
"No, that's not something they tell Cadmean officers."
It likely had to do with which Electors wanted to control Corus, Mikkel reflected, but he still had no idea which side Submarshal Dainyl was on, or whether that might be the best side. But then, Mikkel was having doubts as to whether any side was good for most people.
"When do you think we'll get orders from the Colonel?"
"It could be any time, or it could be weeks."
Mikkel grinned. "I know, I don't have any idea whether we'll be sent back to Norther or to some other place."
Yes, sir.
Another quarter glass passed before first squad returned and Gentzer reported.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.